to go from fighting with a flint-tipped spear to a bronze blade, then to a hard iron sword, to go from a single-shot black powder hand cannon to rapid-fire machine gun. Some of the greatest of man's inventions have been promoted by his desire to be able to fight his opponents better, to gain an advantage on the battlefield. Incredible advances in metallurgy and chemistry that have benefited the whole of civilization were driven by conflict and combat. To be one step ahead of the enemy in terms of the arms your soldiers carry can mean the difference between victory and destruction. The arms race has existed since the time that one warrior could carry a slightly different sword, wear slightly thicker armor, anything that might give him the marginal advantage against his opponent. A marginal advantage when competing for life or death. The race has bankrupted kings, whole empires, and changed the face of modern society and technology. And the race has never been run at such a pace as it is today. The most striking thing about today's soldier is the huge increase in firepower at his disposal. In 1800, a good musketeer could fire 3 shots in a minute. Today's assault rifle fires at 100 times that rate. The squad of 10 soldiers today has more firepower than the 500-strong battalion of the Duke of Wellington's day. Can this vast increase in firepower continue into the future? Probably not, it seems. When the rifle was merged with the submachine gun to produce the assault gun, something of a plateau was reached in personal weapon development. Rates of fire faster than the present 500 to 600 rounds per minute are difficult to achieve mechanically, generate more heat, which has to be got rid of, and mean even more ammunition to be carried by the soldier, most of it to be wasted by inaccurate fire.
A military weapon, a submachine gun or an assault rifle, has been developed literally over the last 100 years to fire somewhere in the region of 500 to 600 rounds a minute. That's a cyclic rate. Doesn't mean you can fire that number of rounds off in a minute. It simply means that you can empty the magazine at that rate of fire. Now, with most weapons firing around 500 or 600 rounds a minute, you have a magazine of perhaps 30 rounds, which means you can expend all your ammunition in 3 seconds. So there's no advantages really to speeding up the rate of fire. In fact, there are disadvantages.
The problem with a burst of fire is, of course, that the first 2 or 3 bullets are likely to be on target. But then as the barrel inexorably rises with a recoil kick, the rest of them are sprayed over the countryside and it's wasted. So it's nice in theory to have a very high rate of fire, but is it accurate? Is it necessary? The bullets have got to be carried, and in any case, the magazine is only going to hold, 30 or 40 or 50 rounds? Now, if you're firing at 1,000 rounds per minute, which is technically possible, your 50 rounds goes in 1/4 of a second. Is that an efficient way to run an army?
But there is more than rate of fire to a good gun. Weight and size matter a lot to the soldier, and both are being reduced. Today's weapons are half the length and the weight of their 1914-1918 ancestors. Israel's Uzi assault rifle is one of the smallest. One version is just 18 inches long and weighs only 8 pounds. It fires, however, at over 500 shots per minute with a velocity of 400 yards a second. The British SA-80 shows a common way to reduce length. The hand, grip and trigger assembly are placed not at the end of the barrel, but halfway along it, so that the barrel can run the whole length of the gun. The result is a shorter gun, but still a good muzzle velocity. Weight is mostly reduced by the use of composite materials. Plastic and aluminium, for example, lower a Spanish version of the American Colt 45 from 40 ounces to just 24. Bullets are another consideration. Diameters have gone from 9mm down to 7.62, down to 5.56, and now 4mm is being looked at. This is less than 0.2 inch, but they are still deadly for two reasons. A bullet's impact depends more on its speed than its size, so that a small increase in speed can mean a big increase in impact, and a small decrease in size can be compensated by a little more speed. The search is therefore on for more efficient gunpowder mixes and better gun design to improve muzzle velocity for these smaller bullets.
The problem is, of course, the stopping power of these things and the confidence that the soldier has that these very tiny, you're talking about something the size of a small fingernail now, that these will have the impact that is required.
Smaller bullets can still be lethal for another reason. They can be designed to inflict wounds that are virtually untreatable. Medical analysis of wounds has shown that bullets sometimes tumble as they enter the body, tearing through a succession of organs before they exit, often far from the entry point. This tumbling can be made to happen by giving the bullet only a little bit of spin as it leaves the barrel, leaving it just slightly unstable in flight. When it impacts, the result is a horrific wound spiraling through the body. Similar wound analysis has shown that bullets can also fragment on impact, producing a spray of tiny metal pieces. Once again, bullets have been specially designed to produce this effect. They fragment on impact, and the result is like a small shrapnel explosion inside the victim's body.
In a curious way, the inhumanity of warfare is manifested in these small weapons as much as it is in the very obvious nuclear weapons, which we're all rightly horrified by. But these stories are really rather horrifying in their cold-bloodedness as well. Still, if you're trying to design the perfect weapon, you have to think about the perfect bullet, and the perfect bullet is by definition one that kills and incapacitates.
In principle, there is now no need for a bullet to have the traditional metal case. The gunpowder itself can be shaped, hardened, and attached to a bullet with no loss to efficiency, but a useful drop in weight. However, the traditional brass bullet plays an important part in sealing the breech when a bullet is fired, and the ejected case also helps reduce the heat generated by fast firing. So, the brass cartridge could be with us for some time to come. Furthermore, tests indicate that electromagnetic pulses of the right strength and frequency could cook off these caseless rounds, with terminal results for the soldier carrying them.
When one looks at the modern round, it's barely changed for 100 years. There's been very little development at all over the last 50 years, other than to decrease the size and to speed up the bullet. So the velocity of the bullet's increased. We seem to be stagnating with bullet design, which tends to indicate that we've reached a state of perfection for the demands of the military, If the military wanted something more perfected, something more sophisticated, something that did a different thing, then there's every reason to believe that minds would turn to that development. But nobody seems to be developing significantly different rounds with any motivation or success. And that seems to indicate that we've reached that state of perfection.
The very shape of the soldier's gun is now being transformed. Its musket ancestry made it long and narrow. But new designs are now short and squat, what is called a bullpup shape.
There's no real reason, of course, except for historical accident, why a rifle should be long and narrow. The musket was long and narrow, and in a sense that sort of design was continued. It was continued too, of course, because it was desirable to have a lengthy barrel, for reasons of velocity, accuracy, and so forth. But modern barrel design means that you don't need a very long barrel, so that goes out. There is efficiency, perhaps, in storing the ammunition. You don't need a banana-shaped magazine sticking out where whatever happens, it's going to get stuck on something. The bullets can be kept within the gun itself. And the some of the bullpup designs have got a rotary feed mechanism, so you just stack the bullets in and the rotary feed looks after them. It's just that much more compact. Similarly with the working mechanism itself, the firing, ejection, reloading system and so forth, can be done perhaps more efficiently with this more compact design.
A good example has been provided by the Austrian firm Steyr-Mannlicher. Their AUG is built on the modular principle. Its function can be changed by simply replacing one module with another, so that the gun can alter from sniper weapon to standard rifle to machine gun in a matter of minutes. It also fires not a bullet, but a flechette, a tiny dart from a plastic cartridge.
This is an interesting idea, and it could perhaps work, but there might be practical problems, such as, do you really carry four different barrels and breech mechanisms with you, and do you carry four different kinds of ammunition with you? It will depend rather upon circumstances. But it is an attempt to give the soldier flexibility in dealing with his enemy, and a flexibility which was attempted, I suppose, in the Second World War by producing a range of different weapons, mortars, hand grenades, the Sten gun, the rifle, and you had specialists who used these. Now the attempt is perhaps to produce a general purpose infantryman, someone who can take on a range of enemies.
But again, it's always a compromise. You can only give a soldier so much before it becomes counterproductive. If you try and make the soldier be everything to all people, you tend to water down his real potential as a rifleman.
More promising is another design now under consideration, a dual-purpose weapon. Called the individual weapon, it consists of two barrels, one under the other. One barrel fires standard bullets for personal protection, and the other fires 20mm cannon shells. These can be explosive, incendiary, or armor-piercing, and can be set to explode at a precise distance from the firer. With them, the soldier can deal with a variety of heavier threats, and this may tip the balance in the weapon's favour.
The new design of the personal weapon, or the individual weapon, which is being favoured, is in fact a form of double-barrelled weapon. You have a small barrel firing a bullet for personal protection against humans, but you have a 20mm cannon shell to use against somebody in a jeep, behind a brick wall, or wherever. It looks as though that composite weapon, or that dual purpose weapon, could be the weapon of the future. And of course, we've had something approaching this already, haven't we? With the American M16 rifle, for example, having a barrel underneath the bullet barrel, as it were, to fire a grenade, a 40mm grenade, some distance. So that's fairly old established.
But the attention being paid now to size, weight and layout does suggest that the soldier's gun has now reached a peak of development, that after 500 years, we are near the end of the explosive-driven metal slug. The best present designs are now around 50 years old, the Uzi of Israel, Russia's ubiquitous Kalashnikov, and the general-purpose machine gun. In 1945, propeller-driven aircraft had reached the limit of design improvement, and were replaced by a totally new system, the jet engine. In the same way, the hunt is now on for entirely new ways to fire something from a gun, and for new things to fire from the gun. One possibility is the EML, the electromagnetic launcher, otherwise known as the rail gun. Its barrel contains a series of powerful electromagnets, and a pulse drives the missile up the barrel, accelerated all the way by the magnets. There is no contact with the barrel, therefore no friction, therefore greater speed. The missile could be a dart or flechette, either single or a spray. The problem is, of course, finding a powerful but portable energy source. Or another kind of change may be needed. For 100 years, assault weapons have fired a stream of bullets, drenching the enemy in fire. But guided weapons are now in vogue on land, sea and air. So, can miniaturization do the same for the soldier? Could he too shoot a tiny fire-and-forget missile to hunt down his enemy? It would be much less destructive than the present area fire, offering great gains in accuracy and in the weight of ammunition a soldier carries. There are two more possibilities, both favorites of science fiction writers. One is the laser. Discovered half a century ago in 1958, this is a means of strengthening or amplifying light waves so that they impact with a lot more energy and, if desired, with a very narrow cutting beam. Since they travel in very straight lines and very fast, the speed of light, lasers are now widely used for range finding and to illuminate a target for a guided missile.
The gains are tremendous, of course. You don't have to carry ammunition. You get tremendous accuracy. You get very high speed. It's the speed of light that you're working with. It is a tremendously effective weapon in a lot of ways. There is no noise, there is no cloud of smoke, vapor, or anything like that. There is no visible evidence of it having been fired, apart from the damage that it does to the far end. And of course, its range is tremendous as well. So the gains are very much there, and it seems likely that it will be produced for a big weapon to begin with, and then miniaturization over a considerable period of time will bring it down to the soldier's level.
But lasers are still a very long way from being a handheld weapon. The generator at present is large, several feet across, and the beam rapidly loses power in the Earth's atmosphere. Nevertheless, the solid-state heat capacity laser being developed in the United States can burn holes through steel plate, and even less powerful lasers can damage the human eyeball. Deliberately causing permanent blindness to soldiers is still on the fringe of the acceptable. A 45-nation conference in 1995 called for a ban on lasers intended to cause permanent blindness. But the advantages of lasers are so obvious that the work to find a killing weapon will go on. No problems with ammunition supply, no problems with trajectory or deflection, no recoil, no noise.
People only turn their minds to developing new types of weapons when there's a need. Back in the 1890s, Gatling strapped an electric motor to a Gatling gun and produced rates of fire which are only just equal nowadays by electric Gatling guns. But in those days, 100 odd years ago, there was no need for a fast firing gun of that nature. So it was abandoned. It only became readopted when air combat became such a speedy thing, you needed a phenomenal rate of fire. So they reintroduced Gatling guns, electric Gatling guns. Unless there is a different need for the soldier with his assault rifle, unless battle tactics change to such a degree that new inventors start designing new weapons for the infantryman, we'll carry on using Kalashnikovs and M16s and SA-80s.
Robots for combat too are a long way in the future. And when they arrive, they are unlikely to be the superhumanoid design of the Terminator movies. Rather, they could be like the simple single-purpose robots used in industry, for welding, for example, in car manufacture. Two kinds have already appeared: the small vehicle used to investigate suspected bombs and remotely guided reconnaissance planes or drones. But specialized robots are very difficult to design for the extremely complex environment of a land battle, and the human soldier will for a long time be a far more flexible instrument. The problem is chiefly one of mobility. Are wheels, treads or legs the best way to navigate around obstacles? There are also problems of communication with the distant human operator, and it may be desirable to put some limited form of artificial intelligence into the machine so that it can make its own instant decisions. But will the public be happy with mechanical warriors which can make their own decisions? Despite the reservations and difficulties, however, there is no doubt that, like lasers, research on robots for war will continue. In the Second World War, the slogan on the Allied side was, "Use ammunition, not men." In future, it could be, use robots, not men.
Everybody weeps for a soldier, but nobody's going to worry too much about robots. And robotic fighting is something that is being looked at very carefully. There are great problems, of course. We've already got some robots already at work, and they're in the air. Drones, pilotless aircraft, which can be guided by a human operator using television screens and so forth, and which one could think you could put limited forms of artificial intelligence into, so that your human operator doesn't have to deal with all of the things. But the point is that air is a simple environment compared with land. And when you think of the multiplicities of problems with land, whether you have a robot which is guided externally by a human operator some miles back, or whether you put some limited form of artificial intelligence into the robot so that they can deal with some kinds of problems themselves. Nevertheless, it's a really difficult problem. One answer might be, of course, to look at robots that are used in industry, where you have simple and single-purpose robots, welding or painting or whatever. But then you've got to think carefully, what kind of environment and what kind of firefight am I designing this robot to deal with? And if he won't have any flexibility at all. If it's outside his parameters, he's helpless.
What of the range of infantry support weapons developed over two world wars, the bazookas, mortars, and grenades, flamethrowers? Do they have any future? In the long term, probably not. They were answers to particular problems in particular wars. Tomorrow's personal weapon, firing 20mm shells, gives the soldier part of the answer to some hardened targets. And if the soldier packs on his back a pair of vertically launched guided missiles, these could cope with larger problems. The high-quality professional armies of the future will want a smaller range of weapons, but more deadly ones. Ever since the invention of gunpowder, the drive has been on to develop more and more deadly weapons. We may, however, have reached a point where this drive is self-defeating. The soldiers of today and tomorrow may well spend less time fighting other high-tech troops and more time in peacemaking, peacekeeping, and riot control. Here, such lethal weapons have no place. The use of these deadly weapons in civilian environments has repeatedly caused too many innocent dead. A range of non-lethal weaponry is therefore under development. Even on the battlefield, non-lethal instruments may have a place. It might be more efficient to strike not at the soldier, but at his supporting technology, using a powerful electromagnetic pulse, for example, to disable his equipment's microcircuits, or more distantly, release substances which turn metal and plastic so brittle that they break. All this new equipment costs a lot of money, and the highly trained soldier of today and the future is frankly far more valuable than the conscript masses of the two world wars. Not to mention that dead soldiers returning in body bags are very bad news politically. High casualties cannot be afforded. And so the soldier now needs more protection than the infamous tin helmets of the two world wars. During the Middle Ages, troops in battle needed to be equipped with sufficiently strong body armor. Fighting in such close combat situations meant that chainmail, shields, and helmets were essential to the survival of the soldier. This concept fell out of popularity through the centuries as battlefields became more expansive and artillery became more sophisticated. But today, body armor design is once more being revived as a valuable protective concept. Though the idea is ancient, the materials are ultra-modern. Kevlar vests and helmets are made from layers of ceramics and composite materials, can stop the average bullet. They played a major part in keeping coalition casualties so low in the recent Gulf War. But one measure always begets its countermeasure, and the future will no doubt see a revival of the age-old duel between personal armor and the missile.
The use of personal armor against small arms fire has always been a bit questionable. Up until recently, the armour had to be so thick, so heavy, that it wasn't really practical for battlefield conditions. Nowadays, if a soldier has to wear MBC clothing and on top of that add armour to it, you're asking far too much of him, especially if he's somewhere in the Middle East where the temperatures are extremely hot. Armour is useful for peacekeeping exercises where you're close up to people who may have submachine gun rounds, that sort of thing. Put a chap on the battlefield and it's not really practicable to encumber him with heavy armour.
We're living in a society in the West which is casualty averse, risk averse, which means that you can fight the wars, but there is a finite degree of political support that the public will have for them, particularly as the wars that have been fought in the past 40 years by America, Britain and so forth have not been national survival wars. The Falklands wasn't, Vietnam wasn't, the Gulf War was not, although an attempt was made to present it as such, which proves the point, in fact. Now, if you're fighting non-vital, non-survival wars, the importance of the casualty level becomes very great, and you've got to think about protecting your soldiers.
And it's not just head and body that must be protected. Mines are a persistent and deadly enemy of the foot soldier. His boot is not just there to keep the wet out, it must also be armoured to save his foot and leg from amputation by a mine.
It is simply too laborious to go looking for these things with bayonets, which they used to have to do, or any other sophisticated minesweeping things. You want to think about a boot which can defy a mine explosion, and that too is a severe problem for the cobblers of the army to try to deal with. But when you think about it, it's a very necessary one, because minefields are the simplest way to defend yourself against soldiers, and they can be terribly, terribly effective. Ultimately, you can get through them, but you lose time. And to lose time in an attack is to risk the success of the attack.
Indeed, the soldier's whole clothing needs re-examination. It must not only protect him from heat, cold, wet, and so on. Even more importantly, it must shelter him from the new dangers of CBW warfare, chemical, biological, and radiation threats. This is a very tall order. Can one suit do all these things, and can it do so without hugely degrading the wearer's combat efficiency? Today's CBW suits are supposedly quite effective, though not yet battle-tested, but they are hot, heavy, and cumbersome. But armoured and protective clothing can only go so far in protecting the soldier. In the future, as in the past, his best defence will lie in suppressing the enemy by superior firepower. And the way to achieve this is not just by increasing his personal firepower. It also lies in far greater integration with heavier units. In the first place, the soldier is learning to fight from and beside his battle transport vehicle, the APC, the armoured personnel carrier. Derived from Second World War half-tracks, which simply carried troops to the battlefield where it left them, today's APC mounts a heavy machine gun and a pair of guided missiles to support the 7 or 8 infantry who ride in it, and have been trained to fight from it and around it. And for further support, tanks can be wheeled in, and devastating firepower delivered by close support helicopters and jets. First attempted in World War II, and often with poor results, vastly improved control and communications have at last made a reality of combined arms fighting. The huge effectiveness of infantry, armor, and air, when efficiently combined, was seen in the US Army's whirlwind advance on Baghdad.
A soldier no longer is a single unit dashing off with his fellow soldiers to fight a battle. He carries so much equipment, and he has need to obtain equipment in a hurry, especially things like the NBC gear, that he's no longer a free man. He is committed to a vehicle. He is committed to backup supplies, other second line support. So he no longer has quite the freedom he had 50 years ago. He now has to work in close cooperation with other elements of the battlefield. I'm sure you'll see as future wars progress, there'll be far less onslaughts with infantry troops, far less hand-to-hand engagements. Warfare will be conducted with other weapons besides the rifle and the infantryman. And the role of the infantryman will change to a much safer role than he's been playing so far.
The biggest change overtaking the foot soldier, however, is neither weaponry nor protection. It is the information revolution, which is transforming war just as it has transformed civilian society. Soldiers could acquire, store, analyze, and communicate information from a stunning range of sources. The old human eyeball, Mark I, is now supplemented by night sights, amplifying very low light levels. Thermal images, which work on heat given off by machines and bodies. Pictures from the infrared spectrum, sound and movement sensors, and electrical energy detectors. Information from these sources, after organization and analysis, will be displayed in head-up form on the front of the soldier's goldfish bowl helmet. Tongue tip or eyeball movement will alter the display. Microchips will create a 3D map of the soldier's surroundings, with the sensor-derived information as an overlay. A video camera with zoom lens will enable any feature to be closely examined. All this information will also be sent on quite automatically to the overall commander's computer. From the hundreds of thousands of inputs from other soldiers, and also from air reconnaissance, radio intercepts, etc., he will be able, for the first time since the battles of Napoleon's day, to be able to see the entire battlefield in real time and make his decisions based on accurate and up-to-date information. For the first time in hundreds of years, generals will be able to see through and beyond the fog of battle. And this will also apply to the individual soldier. As well as having a full picture of his immediate environment, he will have excellent communications with his comrades, often distant or out of sight. Simply to have a personal, miniaturized and convenient to use battlefield radio, with a range of a kilometer or so, can transform the way a squad of soldiers fights. Simulated house-to-house combat, for example, has shown that half a dozen soldiers, equipped with such radios, can coordinate their defense so well that they can hold out against much greater numbers of attackers for long periods.
In the days of Waterloo, Wellington, the Duke of Wellington, or Napoleon could sit on a horse on a high hill and see roughly what was going on. There was smoke of battle, but with a telescope he could manage distances and he could respond immediately to the real life situation. That situation came to an end with the First World War, and it was the real reason for the massacres that took place in the First World War. Generals didn't know until 2 to 3 days afterwards that the attack had been a miserable failure. And in the meantime, reinforcements had gone forward into the maelstrom and been chewn up. So there's a 24-hour, 48-hour, 72-hour lapse in communications. What we have now is an end to that, because it is restoring control of the battle to the generals. It is restoring control of your local environment, through knowledge of your local environment, to the soldier. It is letting everybody know where everybody is. And that is just stunningly important, because most of the time, most of the soldiers don't know where they are, and most of their officers are guessing.
But perhaps even more useful is GPS, the Global Positioning Satellite. Signals from the ground to this satellite system enable a soldier to know precisely where he is to a couple of meters. And because his commander can be automatically cut into the circuit, all the troops and their general know exactly where everyone is. Lasers can designate enemy positions, and GPS will put them exactly on the map. The benefits of this can scarcely be exaggerated. Always in battle, there are commanders and units lost or late or reporting wrong positions. Battlefield commanders of the Second World War confessed that their greatest anxiety was often not the enemy, but their fear that they would go astray in their approach march and be miles out of position when the attack actually started. In the Cold War, the NATO doctrine was, if we can see it, we can hit it, and if we can hit it, we can kill it. the microchip has removed the ifs. Kills are now certain because the battlefield will now be illuminated by day and night through cloud and fog, dust and rain. Soldiers reacted to the firepower revolution by dispersing, spreading out, taking shelter and keeping still. They produced the empty battlefield, full of enemies, though there were none to be seen. The new information technology will in future bear soldiers once again to the unblinking gaze of their enemy. Unless, of course, the electromagnetic spectrum and the microchip can be nullified in ways we can only guess at. The soldier of the future may therefore be in a terrible and contradictory position. Possessing very deadly firepower, protected by armored clothing and supported by heavy land and air units, he is nevertheless so exposed to the enemy and his equally lethal firepower that whole units can be wiped out in a matter of minutes. The intense strain this puts on a soldier will be increased by a war doctrine which insists on 24-hour, round-the-clock fighting to win the battle by relentless and continuous pressure on the enemy. Pep pills of all kinds will be needed to keep the soldier on his feet and alert. All this promises to burn the soldier out much more quickly than the 60 or 70 days of combat which the Second World War showed was about the limit before nervous collapse, or combat fatigue as it was known, made the soldier useless for any more fighting.
A lot of battles, a lot of actions have been decided by sheer fatigue. The German soldiers in the First World War in 1918 broke wide open the Allied front. They advanced for 3 to 4 days, and at the end of it, they were spent. What happened was they simply ran out of energy. They ran out of steam, and the British and French were able to bring troops up by rail and by train and counter them. You can only add the pit pills up to a certain degree. You can train them for fighting in exceptional circumstances, and in the Falklands War, for example, that paid off with the paras and the commando troops being able to trek across that awful terrain for a week with no food, no clean water, with dysentery and diarrhea and so forth, and still fight a night action and evict the Argentinian forces. But that was the best we had. These are people who have been training in the Welsh hills for a long time, and training indeed in Norway to fight under those sort of adverse conditions. It does mean that the army in future is going to be small and professional for a number of reasons. You might want to be training them up to sort of SAS levels, which is very, very demanding indeed.
In the future, psychological casualties arising from extreme stress could equal or exceed those from the actual fighting. And society may have to think far more seriously about rehabilitating its veterans. One way of avoiding or delaying immediate psychological collapse in the future may of course lie in the training of troops. This may focus even more than now on desensitizing them to the terrible sights and sounds they will encounter in battle. Another possible route may be to train them in such immediate and overwhelming aggression that the enemy never has a chance to get started. Shock and awe is a familiar phrase now, but it may be a truly fundamental component of battle in the future. However, this dehumanizing of troops risks leading us into yet another peril. Wars are fought for basically political purposes. Whether it is to prevent Hitler from taking over all of Europe, stopping the spread of communism in Vietnam, or freeing some British citizens from Argentinian rule, military action is always a means to an end. The problem is, as the philosopher of war Karl von Clausewitz observed, that the military means chosen can actually derail the intended end. Specifically, if troops use too much violence or accidentally kill too many innocent bystanders, the original purpose of a war can be lost in a chaotic spiral of hatred and revenge. Hearts and minds are lost, liberators become oppressors, and the war's original political purpose is buried under the bloody pile. The armies of today wield terrible firepower, are trained to fight with unrestrained aggression, and do most of their fighting in heavily populated civilian areas. Will this be the case in the future? can soldiers and their commanders be trained in a selective and restrained use of force? The answer may be yes, to some extent. British troops in Northern Ireland and elsewhere have operated with minimum use of force and few civilian casualties. Other armies have been much more brutal and aggressive. But training soldiers to be both violent and restrained is not easy. Needless to say, there are not many conflicts where the enemy will conveniently agree with you to keep a lid on violence levels. And once they are seriously attacked, troops will want to respond with all the force they can.
I don't think non-lethal weapons will ever be in use for the battlefield. The simple reason one doesn't have the capability to take prisoners that one simply stunned or temporarily put out of action. So, and besides that, soldiers fighting against enemy with death-dealing weapons will not wish to go up against them with inferior weapons. And non-lethal weapons tend to be inferior in terms of knockdown and keeping people down, of course. So there is a role for non-lethal weapons in future, and I'm sure we will see more and more development of them. But whether they'll ever replace the weapons of the battlefield waits to be seen.
The 20th century has seen a huge expansion in the weapons of war, and especially in those used by the ordinary soldier. The drive to invent and perfect, for fame as well as for money, has been as strong in the military as in the civilian technologies. Today and in the future, it will be the result of corporate investment and the recruitment of highly trained scientists by big companies, working to directives of what the armed forces will supposedly need in the medium and long-term future. The most recent and the most unpredictable new technology is ultra-miniaturization, nanotechnology.
What will be going on in 50 years' time from now, given the level of scientific and military development that we've seen over the past 150 years? It's likely to be something which is very new and for which the applications are only beginning to emerge. Nanotechnology. The technology of the very, very small. The technology of engineering at molecular level. You are producing little machines which are smaller than a pinhead. You are not working at the atomic level yet, but you're working at the molecular level. And this is absolutely tiny.
Building mechanisms or organisms at the molecular level is opening the door on a whole new world. Nanotechnology will provide the next step in computers when the present microcircuitry reaches its limits. There are suggestions that in medicine, nanotechnology may produce molecular engines to attack viruses and repair damaged cells. But what can heal can also destroy. And it is possible that initially benign applications of such technology could eventually develop into extremely dangerous warlike ones. For example, the wholesale disabling of an army or a population by swarms of DNA-guided nanomachines.
They could be produced in large numbers, guided perhaps by DNA information, coded to attack all of the population. Some of the population, only the able-bodied males in the population, only the armed forces in the population. This is speculative stuff, but so was atomic engineering, so was nuclear energy in 1900. In 50 years, this could be the new technology which could revolutionize society, but could also revolutionize warfare.
Taking a broad view of the long history of arms, key points emerge. The first big step in weapons development was the ability to kill at close quarters. The second was the ability to kill at a distance. A transition from the simple stone knife or club to the spear, the sling, the boomerang, and the bow. It was a seamless transition. Who knows when the first hand axe was thrown? But it brought a whole slew of factors into play. Range, accuracy, and the fact that a weapon once thrown was no longer available. Development was driven much by the crucial daily hunt for food as by the need for self-defense. But from these first tools grew the first projectile weapons. at the level of the individual combatant, these probably reached their peak in the medieval crossbow and the longbow of the Hundred Years' War. The invention of gunpowder, brought to Europe from China in the 13th century, ushered in a new age for projectile weapons. But it also brought with it a whole new range of problems: muzzle velocity, rate of fire, killing power. Solutions were not easily found. It was centuries more before the first primitive handguns could match the weapons that had preceded them. In this series, we have traced the long and complex story of the development of increasingly sophisticated firearms. But the unbroken line of development from these crude and cumbersome early firearms to sophisticated modern-day infantry weapons is one of refinement of a very simple concept. In essence, they are nothing more than a projectile and a tube. Can the concept be developed further? What will the next radical change be? To quote Donald Rumsfeld, we should worry about the things we don't know we don't know, or, more comprehensibly, expect the unexpected.